Look at this. This beautiful, heavenly cream of mushroom soup. Oh, I tell you what, this is the way to go. Mmm. Oh, man. Wait till you try this dish. It's absolutely heavenly. Hello! Welcome back to Texas Cooking Today. On this episode of Texas Cooking Today, we're going to make a cream of mushroom soup. This isn't going to be your ordinary blended over cream of mushroom soup, no. This is going to be hearty, it's going to be full-bodied, this is going to be exciting like no other cream of mushroom soup you've ever tasted. So I tell you what, come over this way, let's take a look at these wonderful ingredients we have to work with, and let's make the world's best cream of mushroom soup. Now, on our ingredients that we have here, of course, king of our dish is going to be the mushroom. This is a cream of mushroom. And we also have some leek here. The leek helps to bring out a little more earthy flavor from this and makes it a little more rich. It doesn't become all leek flavored, though, because we're not going to overpower it with it. Now, what I have here is about a pound of the white button cap and a pound of baby bellas. And you can use also the cremini, and so you'll know the difference. A baby bella is just an older version of a cremini. That's all it is. Cremini is when they first come up and they're fresh and young, and a baby bella can have 6 to 8 more days on it than a cremini would have. So that's the biggest difference there. Now, with the leeks, it doesn't matter if you're using small, medium, or large. What we're looking for when we're finished, the amount of leek that we're going to want, is going to be roughly 3/4 of a pound to a pound of chopped leek. And I'm going to be cutting this in about 1/2-inch ring segments, but we have to process them and clean the insides out first. Over here, other ingredients, the only seasoning we'll use is just a little bit of salt. I have some cheese. I recommend Grana Padano cheese for this. You can also use Parmesan or Romano or Asiago. Any of these Grana cheeses will work great in this dish. And we're looking for about 3/4 of a cup to a cup of freshly grated cheese there. 1/2 cup of flour, 4 tablespoons cubed butter, and some olive oil. We're going to use about 1/2 cup to 3/4 of a cup of olive oil, roughly. 1 quart of chicken stock. Now, if you're vegetarian and you want to use something different, go with a vegetable stock on this, okay? I have back here 1 quart of heavy cream, and right over here, 2 cups of milk. Now, I probably won't use all of that milk. I might not use any of it. It really depends on the viscosity of the soup once I get all of the rest of this combined. If I feel I want a little more liquid there, I have milk set aside just for that, okay? Now, let's move right on to processing our vegetables. Let me show you how to get these taken care of and cut up just the right way. Now we're ready to take care of slicing up all of our goodies. What we want to do on processing these mushrooms, I don't necessarily like to use the stalk on a mushroom when I'm cooking it into something like this. So what I'm going to do is just take those and push them sideways, and that'll snap them right out of there. That's all you have to do. And if it leaves just a little bit behind in it, you know, let's not lose any sleep, like if you just get a little bit left over. Now, also, you can save this, use it in vegetable stock. We're going to have some of that leek left over that can go into a vegetable stock also for you. If you like just using up all of your ingredients, that would be a great thing to do with it. Now, this one, they went ahead before it came out and cut it. Somebody cut it. So let me remove that. We'll save what's left of it. There we go. A whole bunch of little mushrooms rolling around. So as you can see, a pound of these mushrooms is actually quite a bit. And of course, we are reducing it substantially by removing these stems. But it's not, like I said, going to seriously affect this dish. Now, we have finished removing all of those stems. So what I want to do is prepare all of my caps for cooking. Now, some of my caps I'm going to be chopping up, and some of them I'm going to have sliced. And so what I'm going to be wanting are some nice little quarter inch thick, or actually I should say about eighth inch thick slices of these mushrooms. And the whole thing done just
that
way.
Now
let's
take a moment in our cutting to go over the safety guidelines of using cutting boards and knives.
First of all, what you want to remember is if you're using the colored cutting board system or if you're using a multiple cutting board system, you always need to use the board you use for vegetables with vegetables. Never use it with meats or anything else. So I'm using my green board, which is vegetables only. And I'm going to be cutting all of my vegetables on this. If I was going to be cutting meats for this dish or anything like that, of course we would switch to a different board. Now, and that's so you don't get cross-contamination. On holding your food, you want to make sure that the tips of your fingers don't get cut. So you don't want to hold your food like this. You want to curve this lower knuckle back towards the thumb and have this part of your knuckle vertical. And this actually becomes the cutting guide for the knife. The knife can slide along the side of it easily while the tips of your fingers are protected because they're curved under. Now, your thumb always goes behind over here. So when we're holding our food, knuckle vertical, and I can use that knuckle, I just look down at it to make the thickness of my slices. Now when holding that knife, when you're using something that's a very delicate cut like this, if you want to hold it by the handle, you can. However, the knife can roll on you this way. If you will pinch your knife, thumb and forefinger, and wrap these fingers around the handle, that'll give you a much better control over that knife, okay? So, there's our safe cutting guide. Please be careful. Cut all of this up. Once you get all of yours cut up, then go ahead and restart your video. So go ahead and pause here, and you can catch up with me. And once you've got all of yours sliced, then we'll get right on to what we need to do next. Okay, so we have arrived at that point where we have all of our mushrooms chopped up. Now, what we're going to be doing is cooking some of these as sliced mushrooms, but we're also going to cook some of them as chopped mushrooms. And the idea here is I'm trying to get a more bold flavor release without having to use an electric blender or food mill or anything like that. So what I'm wanting to use is anywhere from a quarter to a third of the mushrooms of each batch. And since they're all going to be chopped, it doesn't really matter if I chop them together. I'm looking at, like I said, somewhere between a quarter and a third of each. And I think I have that right about there. So we're going to chop these up, put them all up in this bowl. And they don't have to be like fine chopped. And again, let's talk about how to handle that knife. This is one of those times when you want the blade up close because of the way we're handling it. We don't want it to slip. Thumb underneath, fingers on the top. See? Isn't that easy? And these don't have to be a fine chop. This is going to be something of a coarse chop. Once I get them cut down to a certain point, I don't mind doing that, but at the beginning, they kind of fly all over the place if you try to do this. So, make it a little smaller, yes. It's like having a school bell here. Okay, we're almost there. That didn't take that long, did it? Not that hard. So, we're going to go with it at that point, just like that. And what we have pieces here, from like about half inch size pieces down to maybe eighth inch type pieces, and that's just perfect. It's a good random assortment.
And the idea here, these smaller pieces do a beautiful job of, number one, releasing their flavor in full, and then shrinking up so much that they're really not even noticed once the soup has been cooked down. All right, there we have it. So, and that looks like about 3 equal parts. Let's get these together. I've got one part white sliced, one part chopped combined, and one part of the baby bella sliced, or cremini. Okay, now, we're gonna move on to our leeks. I need to clean up my area here. Well, now that we have our mushrooms out of the way, we're gonna get down to our leeks. Now, these are honestly the smallest leeks I've ever seen in my entire life. If you were gonna be using a large leek, and they come out pretty big sometimes, about the size of your arm, if you're using a big one like that, probably 1 to 1.5 is gonna be enough. If you're using medium-sized ones, which are about twice the size, then you're probably going to be needing about 2 of those. So what we're looking for, like I said, though, is by the time we're done, we want close to about 3/4 of a pound to a pound of just the lighter green and a little bit of this darker green up here, but not a whole lot, and I'll show you how much. Now, what we want to do first, these have already been washed. I want to cut off that root end, just like that. Oops, actually, I made a mistake. Don't do that. I want to remove my top stalk, and I want to show you why you don't do that. Just going to remove that green. Now, again, if you like saving vegetables for stock, this is really good stock material here, what I'm cutting off. And it would make a very good tasting vegetable stock. Now, the reason you leave the root end intact, we're going to make a slice down the side of this, and that root end will actually help hold it in place. And what I want to do is to hold my little paring knife, I still got some mushroom on it, and I want to dive the nose in. Now, when I hold my paring knife, I want my finger up here for one reason. I don't want the nose of my knife to go too deep, and that finger becomes a cutting guide for me, so I don't go all the way through it. I'm going to pull back like so, and what this does is it opens up this leek and it exposes the inside layers, and that way I can wash them out. Now, frequently leeks will have dirt all up inside of them, and it's just kind of a natural part of the way leeks grow. Now, on this one, I'm going to step back from where I left the end of it, make my same cut, and there we go. Now, as long as I'm gentle, that shouldn't break open on me. So I need to do this on all of them, make my little cut down the side, and then we're going to wash these out. So even though you wash the outside of the leek, suddenly you realize, uh-oh, I've got to wash the inside. If you've never used these, you're in for a treat. Leeks are a really good flavor. They're not as strong as your average onion. They're very mild, and they give a very warm, earthy tone to any dish you put them in. Now, if you're really not too sure and you want to go ahead and use a scale, and that's what we're going to do here. Okay, my scale is telling us that we have 13.58 ounce, and so roughly what we have here is about our 3/4 of a pound mark, you know, because, you know, 16 ounces is going to be a pound. So we're right on mark as far as how much leek we have here. Now, what we want to do, just take our leeks, give them a good wash on the inside. We just peel back those layers, let the water run down through it. If there's any loose dirt in there, just wash it right out. Generally, you don't have too much dirt down where the white is, up where the green is on the spoiler. So just do all of yours the same way, and when you're done with this, we'll get right on to chopping. Now, let's get on with processing these out. We're going to start by removing that root, and what I want to do is to cut each one of these stalks into about 3/8 inch thick slices, just like that. Now, 1/2 inch would be a little bit too wide, and I think 1/4 inch a bit too narrow, but that 3/8 seems to be dead on. So go ahead, process all of your leeks this exact same way. Now, sometimes you get to the outer layer and it's a bit rough. You can pull it out. go. Now again, remember the chopping techniques that we talked about earlier. Pull that one outer layer off. Holding that knife up on that blade. Keep those fingers turned under. And remember, that finger becomes a cutting guide for you. Just slowly grab your hand back. See there? Let me get you a side view on that. Again, the finger straight up. Now it's hard for me to see over to the other side of the blade. So likely my slices aren't perfect right now. They're probably close enough. There we go. Now, again, if you're going to push goods off of your blade, be careful if you run your finger down it. You see me do that and it looks like I'm about to slice my hand open. And what I'm doing is I'm making contact with the back of the blade like that, not with the cutting edge at all. The safe way of really doing that kind of stuff is just to push it straight off like that and away from the edge. That way you're sure not to hurt yourself. When you see me use my hand to gather up pieces like this, my edge is always turned down as if I was trying to shave hair off of the surface of this board. And that way it will not come in contact with my skin. It'll do me no damage. So be careful on your knife handling techniques. With that root. These outer layers on the pitch, keep the inner ones at night. Be careful with your cutting. You don't want to hurt yourself. Don't get in too much of a rush. Speed comes with experience and time. Now right here, you know, you're looking at 40 years plus experience in the kitchen. So that didn't come overnight. None of it did. So if you're young to cooking, you're new to cooking, be patient. You'll get there. And with videos like this that are cook-along videos, you're way ahead. Now that we have all of this finished and chopped up, beautiful, isn't it? These, if you'll notice, they probably didn't make you cry. They have a very mild odor, and they are just wonderful tasting. Like I said, mild and earthy. So let's go ahead and start on our soup. It's about time, isn't it? Now I went ahead and ground up that grana padano cheese. And that one little block did provide me with more than enough cheese for this dish, okay? So I finished that one out. I don't ever bother with that rind because it's just a little too tough to use in cooking. So there we have beautiful grana padano. Now, on for our cooking, we have a couple of pans out here. One large fry pan and a pot with a large wide bottom on it. Now, if I was cooking a small amount, I would just do it in this one pot. But I have a lot to cook here. There's a lot of vegetables. So I want to spread that initial cooking out between both of these pans. Now, what we've done is taken the time to do what's called the setup method, where we have everything set up. The flour's pre-measured, the butter's pre-measured. You have your oil ready to use, your salt ready to use. You have your mushrooms measured and sliced. The leek is already sliced. Chopped mushrooms. Everything's measured. We don't have to stop and worry about chopping up leeks while these are cooking. That would be crazy, okay? So what we want to do is start by heating up our pans. And I've just put a high heat under these. And we're going to bring them up to a nice hot temperature before we go throwing anything down in them. Whenever you're cooking in stainless, you want to heat your pan first. And that way, you'll get good cooking and nothing's going to stick. This is proper cooking. Now we need to know whether our pans are hot enough. And of course we just used the water method. Okay, the water evaporated immediately, which tells me that that pan is not quite hot enough, but it's getting there. okay, water droplets are just now beginning to dance in it. So what I want to do is go ahead and get some oil in my pans, and I want to use, to start with, right about 2 tablespoons worth. If there's any of that water left in there, it's going to crackle a little bit. Don't worry about that. Now, I'll just put all of my cremini in the first one, and we're going to put those white button caps right in that second one. Go ahead, turn those mushrooms over. Get them well coated with the olive oil. The olive oil is going to soak right in. Mushrooms are like a little sponge. So we're not afraid to go ahead and add a little extra. Lost one. Okay. We'll survive. Same thing on this pan. Wild with it. There we go. And no, we don't play the 5-second rule here. If it comes out of the pan, it stays out of the pan. Okay. So we just want to cook these down a little bit. I know it's a little bit loud in here, but whenever we're frying, it always takes over the microphone. Now I want to cook these down just a little bit. It's going to be just a few minutes worth of cooking. I need to lower my temperature to medium high. Now what I'm getting here, it's just a light browning. Okay, it's just been a few minutes now, only about 4 minutes, I would say, and I'm getting a nice reduction on the size pans. So what I want to do next, and that was, I used 2 pans just to get this started. I'm going to combine these, like so. Pull the rest out. And that's one thing mushrooms are going to do, is they're going to release moisture and they're going to reduce in size and they're going to cook down. That's why using 2 pounds wasn't really outrageous on this. Now what I want to do is I'm going to go ahead and pour in our chopped mushroom. And again, we're going to need some oil. I'm going to stir this so we get some cooking on the smaller pieces. Back up to the high heat again. Okay, we have that in. They're going to start cooking and releasing. And I want to go ahead at this point and put this leek, all of our leek in there. A little dabble. Looks like a lot of olive oil. Well, like I told you before, we're going to be using about half to three quarters of a cup. And right now we're up to about a half a cup of use, roughly. So what looks like we're going to have here is a very hearty soup. And it's going to cook down beautifully. It's going to be tasty. This is a wonderful soup for the holidays. It's a good meal starter for Christmas. Now what we're going to see here is as this cooks, we're going to see again a reduction in total volume. So I expect this to drop down not quite half of what it is now, but about to two-thirds of what it is now. Something else I want to do, I'm going to cover that, and as it cooks, it's going to go ahead and build some steam. That steam is going to work on those leeks on the top, and it's going to cause them to wilt and to sweat. And as they do that, that's going to soften them enough to make them a good quality soup and easy for eating. We don't want anything in this to be really too firm, but we want a really hearty, kind of chunky type of soup in this cream of mushroom soup. And during this initial cookdown, we want to make sure that we stir this. The smell that's coming out of this is unbelievable. Oh, so rich. And all we have is just mushrooms and leeks. And yet we get this beautiful harmony of flavor and odor. And of course that odor is part of, you know, the whole flavor sensation, the experience. Let's keep cooking. Stir it frequently, about every minute or two, until we get that cooked down nice and soft. We don't want anything in there caramelizing too much. All right, we're right about 5 minutes total cooking time right now. I'm just going to add a little bit of salt to this. I'm going to put in about a teaspoon here. In just a moment, as this cooks down a little bit more, we're going to be putting in our butter and flour. And add a little more olive oil. We're gonna make us a nice little roux in this. And that way, as that flour cooks down, we're gonna have to cook it a bit. Once that cooks down, it's gonna make us a nice thick base. Now, my total cook time has been up to about 10 minutes now. And if you'll notice, this has reduced a great amount, just like I mentioned that it would do. I'm way down. So what we want to do now is just go ahead and work in the butter. And break that apart. This is when we want to sprinkle in our flour. And we'll stir this a little bit and add the rest. This is going to make a rather thick mess. Some of it's going to stick to the bottom of the pan. Don't worry about that. What we got to do now is cover this, because I have to cook this flour down. It needs to experience some heat for a few minutes at least. Here's where we add in that extra fat, that extra olive oil I mentioned to you before, bringing it up to about that 3/4 of a cup mark. Here we go. Now, while this looks like something of a mess right now, in a little bit, it's going to look heavenly. So, cover that again and keep on cooking. We're going to, like I said, cook about another 4 to 5 minutes on this. And then, once that's cooked that flour fully, and we need to stir it about once every minute. Once the flour is cooked in fully, then we're going to mix in our liquids. I have just arrived at about 4 minutes of cooking time. I'm smelling a good odor from the flour itself included in this, and it's starting to brown slightly on the bottom. So I want to go ahead put in that stock. We're going to bring this up to a boil and we're going to let it simmer for a little while. And what I'm going to allow that to do is I want that liquid to simmer off somewhat. I want to cook off about at least a cup of the total volume of liquid. So I'll bring this to a boil. That's exactly what we'll do. Now what I'm doing here is I am running my spoon across the bottom of the pan, and it's breaking loose that fond, helping it to mix. A lot of that fond is that cooked flour, and as we break it loose and it mixes in with this chicken stock, it's thickening, as you can see here. And of course, I keep saying chicken stock. If you're vegetarian, I guess that would be your vegetable stock, right? That's great. Well, I guess if you're a vegan, you're going to be changing up this dish a whole lot. That would mean no cream, no milk, no butter, no chicken stock. Wow. But I imagine it would be interesting. Maybe I should try that someday. So I want to bring this to a boil. Once it comes to a boil, I'll reduce the temperature and I'm just going to simmer it until it puts off about that one cup of volume that I'm looking for. There, now we have this beautiful, thick, somewhat brown soup that is the soup base, really, that is now starting to thicken, and we're melding those flavors together. We're finishing softening any of that leek that hasn't been fully cooked and letting the mushrooms finish releasing. And the beautiful part about this part of it is there's just so much flavor that's built within these moments of allowing this to simmer. Now I've reduced the temperature of this to a low, and I'm going to let this continue, as I mentioned, so we can get some of that moisture out of it, and we're going to be cooking it for about 15 to 20 minutes. Our mixture has now been cooking for just a little bit over 18 minutes. I've been stirring this about every minute and a half to 2 minutes, gently. It's just gotten thicker, of course, as the moisture steamed out. And so, we're at that point now. Before we move forward, though, go ahead, put a spoon in there, and get a good taste of this. Find out if there's any adjustments that you need. First of all, I can tell you, it's extremely rich. The leek adds a nice tone to it. It sets in the background from the flavor of the mushrooms, of course. And it's just full-bodied. It is a little bit shy on salt. However, I don't want to salt it. I want to, I got a mushroom hanging. Looky there. Let go. Scratch this. Anyway, I don't want to salt this right now because remember we're going to put some grana padano cheese in this, and that stuff is salty. So we don't want to throw our balance off. I'll salt it after that if it needs. Now, I'm going to drop the heat on this for just a moment. And we're going to start working in that cream. So like I said, you're looking at about 20 minutes worth of simmering. You notice I don't just jump that cream in all at once, I work it in. You don't want to get your viscosities in one pan, two separate ones from another. Otherwise, strange things like creating lumps or uneven pockets of texture happens. You don't want that. There's our quart of cream. Thereby making this a cream of. And it is pretty thin right now. However, this has yet to cook down and that cheese has yet to thicken it also. So I'm going to put my flame back under it, but I'm going to keep it low. I want to start working in some of that cheese. With all this cream, it will just melt right into it. Looking at here is an exceptional looking soup so far. One that we've just made ridiculously rich. I said this is going to be a cream of mushroom that's very full bodied. That was about a cup, roughly, of grated grana padano. If I was using Parmesan, I might use like 3/4 of a cup. It is a little more robust in its flavor. I want the cheese to make it a richer flavor. Whoops, we're losing light over here. There we go. Backup fixture came on. Okay. Now again, that leak. I've just got to bring this up in temperature. And at this point I want to put a thermometer in it so I can kind of keep a close eye on what that temperature will be. This is just a real smart thing to do whenever you're cooking with dairy, especially dairy. That way you can get a good idea of exactly what is or is not happening on it. So let's bring this up in temperature. And I'll restart the film as it comes up to about 150. Now my soup has come up over 150 degrees, and this is a perfect time for me to test this to get a good idea of where my flavors are, how it's going on in this, and whether or not I need some salt. Now I'll say this, the flavor of that is really warm, inviting, delicious, and just a little bit more salt is called for. So I'm going to put in right about a teaspoon. I'm going to work that down. Do not allow your temperature to come over 180 degrees. Okay. And if you don't have a thermometer, a good sign is you're building a froth on the edge, little bubbles, and you know, just like when you're heating cream or scalding milk. You get that frothing on the edges and the steaming, of course. And you don't want to bring it to a boil. That's the idea there. There we go. It's coming up. It's around 160 now. I'm going to give it just a moment before I taste it again. And if any necessary final adjustments are needed, at that time I'll do that. Now my soup's temperature is just a little bit under 175 degrees, so I'm dropping the temperature on this. I'm going to give it another stir, and then it is time to plate this up. Now, I'm going to use my whisk to make sure that the lower edge is cleaned out good. Now, as with all things in the kitchen, presentation is very, very important. So what I want to do is to make this a beautiful looking dish. However, it's rather simple and humble, just kind of white with little specks in it. So that means we gotta add color or design or both on top. And that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna add a little of each, and I'm gonna show you some neat little tricks here. So I've already turned my heat off. Let's grab that ladle. All right. Now, for a beautiful attraction on this, I want some green. I don't want to use this green onion, and I want to use the upper part of it. I'm just going to cut some very simple, thin rings. And this way I have something to decorate the top with, that it has a nice color to it. Good hearty soup. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? This is a cream of mushroom that'll really speak to you. And one more ladle. There we go. Good and hearty. Set this to the side here. Now, let's get a better view of this so you can see what I'm going to be doing here. Now, the items that we have for decorating our soup are, as I mentioned before, we have some of the green onion, but also have just a little bit of cream here. Now, this soup has changed color to the point where I can use this. Let me see if I can do this left-handed. And I just want to make a nice little dot. And I'm going to do another one right here. I want to do three of these. Now, to make a design in that simple enough, what we're going to do, and there's a couple ways of doing this. You can use your paring knife like I used for cutting up my there we go. Just going to pull that out into a nice little star. The other way, we can use a toothpick, if I can get one of these. Left hand this for you. Now what I'm doing is pulling out and up at the same time. This is kind of tricky. There we go. Now, of course we want a little bit of the green running across the top. There we go. And I'm keeping it kind of simple. I just want a nice straight little line of that onion. Now we have it. Very simple, very easy to do. That's a yummy dish. Well, there it is. Beautiful cream of mushroom soup. This gets down to simplicity, more of a country style soup. Delicious, hearty. Oh man. The marriage of flavors on this is just remarkable. It really is. Adding that leek into a cream of mushroom really sets it apart. Like I said, it gives it a more full body, better flavor. It didn't stop being a cream of mushroom, but it did become a lot heartier. I tell you what, wait till you try this. You're going to be hooked on it. It's going to become one of your favorites. Well, thank you. Thank you for watching my show. Thank you for watching Texas Cooking Today. And a special thank you to my subscribers. Thank you very much. If you haven't subscribed, please do. We've got some great stuff here. And you have a good day. Thank you for watching Texas Cooking Today, the show where you can get great recipes and the best techniques are taught.
Please subscribe to Texas Cooking Today, where you will always find something hot and ready to eat.